Well, welcome everyone. This is Basics of Photography. If you're looking to maybe pick up a new hobby or just learn a bit more, you're in the right place. My name is David. I'm a graphic design intern at The Zone. But when I'm not doing graphic design, I'm doing photography. So, this is some of the work I've done for The Zone. These are recruitment photos that I took for the past quarter. And one thing that I really love about photography is taking candids. I love candids. They really capture emotions and the moments. So why take better pictures? Why are you interested in taking better pictures or just pictures in general? My opinion is that, first of all, pictures capture a moment, right? Maybe you're taking, you know, a picture of food for your Instagram, or maybe you're taking a picture with your family or your friends. In any case, I feel like the majority of photography revolves around capturing the moments and the emotions and the memories of that frame in time. Personally, I love looking back at my old photos. I love remembering crazy moments, sad moments, happy moments. Whatever they are, you know, photos are a great way to capture those moments in time. I think learning how to do photography, if you already are familiar with it and if you want to get better, regardless of what it is, doing photography is a great way to expand your horizons. For me, I'm always experimenting, I'm always trying to do new things, and even as someone who's done photography for many years now, it's always a new experience, it's always a great way to learn something new. And finally, photography is a great way to express yourself artistically. Today I'm going to be talking about some techniques that you can use, but in no way, shape, or form are these things that you have to follow or things that you have to do. There are ways that I express myself artistically, and in the same way, you should be able to feel free to use photography as just a tool of expressing what you want other people to see and how you see the world. So that's why you want to take some pictures. That's why you might want to learn something new. This is the question that I get asked all the time. You know, like, I want to do photography, but I don't have a good camera. I don't have a DSLR, and, you know, like, looking at all that fancy equipment, it can get pretty intimidating. But in my opinion, you don't need a fancy camera. You don't need all those lenses or all those filters, whatever. If you have a phone camera and that's all you have, then that's perfect. That's great. That's actually really good. When I started out doing photography, I had this very janky old camera. The screen of it was like the size of a Ritz cracker, and the resolution was not that good at all. You can imagine most phones these days are a lot better than that. But that's where I started. I started off with a very bad camera that didn't do that well. And in my opinion, it's really more about, like I mentioned before, like capturing that moment. It's about how you make that composition rather than the quality of the photo. It doesn't have to be super high resolution. It doesn't have to look incredible. As long as that photo means something to you, then that's what should matter to you. All right. So let's get into like the thick of it. These are some fundamentals that I've picked out based on my personal experience. There's a lot more out there, but these are just the four things that I found in common within my photography, and I'll be briefly breaking them down. It's space, framing, perspective, and lighting. And so if you remember anything at all from this presentation, you know, try to remember these four things when you go out and take those pictures. Hopefully one of these things will stick with you and you'll remember, oh, I should try this, or I should try that. Right, so let's start with space. I wanna talk about the rule of thirds first. And this is something that is really common. Like if you do any photography tutorial, you'll probably hear about the rule of thirds. If you're not familiar with what the rule of thirds is, well, basically you take your picture, your frame, you turn it into a tic-tac-toe grid. And the idea is to kind of put your subject off-centered. Like for example, in this picture, I have the car on the highway on the left side of the frame. And that's kind of like in the bottom left corner over there. The idea is that it draws more interest to the picture. This is a similar example. You can see how I have these two stacks of rocks. Both of them are not in the center, but they're on the sides. So looks a bit more interesting. But you might ask, I've seen plenty of pictures without the rule of thirds, and you're correct. The rule of thirds is not really a rule. It's just one way you can frame your things. You can use symmetry. For example, in this picture that I took of my friends, I thought it was a great time to use symmetry because, well, you put a line in the middle, it almost reflects perfectly. And I also really wanted to focus on my friends too. So here the rule of thirds wasn't really something I wanted to use, and that's okay. Same thing here, you can just forget about the rule of thirds and say, hey, I really want to focus on this one person. So that's maybe a time when you want to use a centered composition. Maybe you want to take a portrait picture. And so you put the subject right in center. And so the thing with these three different techniques is that it really boils down to what you want to focus on and what the situation calls for. Personally, I like to use a rule of thirds when I feel like I want to emphasize the subject as well as the background. You can see here how I wanted to include the car, but I also wanted to capture just the vastness of the mountains and the hills. Same thing here, I wanted to give the ocean some space while also making it seem kind of interesting with the rocks in the foreground. Here, the background didn't matter to me whatsoever. The only thing I wanted to focus on with my friends, and symmetry was a great way of drawing more interest to the picture. Again here, there's a lot of people sitting around the subject. If I use rule of thirds, then that might have made the picture more confusing. So ultimately, these are just different tools that you can use in different scenarios to make your picture look better. All right, we're gonna move on to framing. Framing is basically how you use your environment or objects around it to enhance the focus of your subject. Here, I call this foreground interest. You can notice how I have like heads of audience members in the foreground. Some of them are blurry, some of them are a little bit clearer, but it adds that feeling of depth and dimension to the shot, and it makes it more focused on the speaker himself. It feels like you're sitting in the audience, and it feels like you can actually just narrow down and really look at that guy. Angles. I guess this is, I don't know if it's framing or not, but I wanted to throw it in somewhere. I think angles are really powerful because all it takes is kind of turning your camera a little bit, and instantly your shot feels a bit more dynamic. And the reason I think this works, don't quote me on this, it's just my own experience, but if you're looking at the world through your very own eyes, a lot of it is parallel. You probably aren't walking around with your head tilted to one side. And that's kind of why angles look more interesting, because it's not something that you constantly see, it's a little bit more dynamic too, you know. I think that if I took this shot of the nurse at a parallel perspective, then it might not have been as interesting as this picture where you can see that there's like some tilting with the table and like this little object in the foreground. Angles are great to use. And finally, one more thing is sometimes you want to fill the frame. And again, this kind of boils down to what you want to capture in the subject. In this case, I really wanted to focus on the subject's expression, is how happy she was. And so it wouldn't have done it justice if I just stood far away and took a picture of her without seeing her face. Filling the frame allows you to just narrow down on that subject. And you can see that the commonality between all these framing techniques is that it just boils down to what you want any viewer to see, what you want to focus on. Okay, perspective. So if you're familiar with any art, you might have heard of like a worm's eye view, bird's eye view. That's pretty much what I'm going to talk about today, and why you want to use certain perspectives and what kind of impact we'll have. So on the ground, or worm's eye view. So this kind of view gives a feeling of grandeur and it makes objects seem bigger than usual. You can see this is a picture that I took in Osaka. And if you've ever been to Japan, if you've ever seen pictures of Japan, you know that in very populated tourist heavy areas, there's a lot of tall buildings. You know, and it's hard to kind of capture that feeling of tall buildings if you're just taking a picture straight on and you can't really see all the buildings. In this case, a worm's eye view is really good because it makes the building seem super tall. It exaggerates that aspect of the picture. And so it really feels like you're being surrounded by these buildings. On the other hand, oh, sorry, one more slide. Works on people too. Let's say you're taking pictures of your friend and you want them to look taller, you want them to feel more empowered. This is a great way to use a worm's eye view. It might have to get a little dirty and on the ground. This is a picture that I took when I was literally laying on the grass, but my friend here is a relatively short person. With that on the ground perspective, she looks taller than usual, especially with the pose she's in right now. It makes her look a lot better. All right, bird's eye view. In my opinion, I don't do bird's eye views all the time because they're hard to get. This picture was taken in San Francisco with a drone, which is probably not the most feasible thing for everyone, but I want to point out that it's also a great technique to use when you want to capture a large number of objects. Imagine you're in New York and you're going up to the Empire State Building, and you're at the very top, you look out and you see all these buildings, all these tall skyscrapers. It always looks amazing when you take a bird's eye view picture of all the skyscrapers, and because it captures just the sheer number of buildings in the city. But maybe you're walking in the streets in New York. Maybe you're not at the very top. You can also do that worm's eye view and just capture just how tall one building is, right? There's two different perspectives you can use, both of which capture a different feeling about the same subject. All right, here's a picture from the Zone Instagram that I found. I guess it's technically a bird's eye view because it's from the top looking down, but it was a really good choice because it allowed the photographer to capture a multiple number of items on the table. Obviously, you probably wouldn't use like a worm's eye view for this. I don't know how that would work out, but you can kind of see the trend here. This is, I don't know if this is an official term or not, but this is something I personally love to do. It's called over the shoulder. And this is great for when you have somebody doing something or when you want to capture the moment where you're right next to the person. I think that over the shoulder shots really make it feel like you're standing next to the person so you can see both what they're doing and who the person is. You can kind of see some angles too. I've used angles here. That's applying past knowledge. Here's another example, the same event, but I've got that over the shoulder feel. It feels like I'm standing right next to her because I am standing next to her. But if I look at this picture, you know, it captures that feeling of intimacy. And it's also a little bit dynamic with those angles that I threw in. Lighting is huge. So even if you forget everything that I just rambled about in like the past 10, 15 minutes, hopefully you remember lighting. Because lighting can turn the same subject with the same composition from something that looks kind of meh to something that looks amazing. And I don't have too many examples of like good or bad lighting, but I think if you look back at some of these old pictures that I took, you can notice how a lot of it is due to good lighting. For example, here the sun in the background and the way that it lights up the entire subject, it's good lighting. But anyways, we'll move on. What is bad lighting? Bad lighting in this situation here can be dark or unflattering, especially if you're doing pictures of people, right? I think when you take pictures of people, you want them to look good. You want them to look at that picture and be like, hey, I look decent in that. That's not really going to happen if your lighting is kind of bad. In this case, well, I think it's okay, but the shadows in the background are kind of weird. They're like going in different directions. The faces of the subjects look very oily just because of how direct that lighting is. And overall, I wouldn't use this for something on social media. But this is a picture taken in the same place, just at a slightly different area where the lighting's a lot better. Here the lighting is even. We don't see any weird shadows in the background, no weird shadows on the faces. There is a bit of shine on the foreheads, but that's fine, I think. It's not too distracting. So how do we find good lighting? That's the question, right? Like, where do we get these spots where people will look okay? One thing that I think always works really well is natural window light. So if you're inside and you want to take a picture, try to find that window. Usually I find that window light is more diffusive and it's not always harsh. In this case here, like the subject is sitting a bit further away from the window. So the light that's being cast on her face isn't too contrasted with the other side of her face. So we get a more even feel to it while at the same time kind of lighting up her face. Let's say it's nighttime, okay? You don't have a window or like it's dark. Well, there's still ways of finding good lighting. I think if you can get indirect lighting where it's more diffuse, where it's more even, like an overcast sky, for example, if you're outside and there's no direct light, then that's probably a better chance of getting good lighting. You see in this picture here, We don't have any very harsh lights. Some of the places are a bit dark, but overall, I think the lighting is even here. Okay, so those were some compositing techniques. Let's talk about candids, because I love candids and it's kind of my specialty. So I hope you guys can maybe benefit from this. If you don't know what candids are, I like to define them as kind of in-the-moment shots, unplanned shots, shots that really capture the emotions of a moment in time. Here's my grandma. She doesn't like her photo being taken, but I guess she was having a good day that day, and I managed to get this picture. Here's a picture that I took at a concert with like a bit of acting in between, and there's a lot happening in this picture. You know, there's like a guy making a sarcastic face, there's like a girl pouting, the cloth is kind of flying. There's a lot happening, and it's really dynamic, and it's fun to look at. Here's my friend giving my friend a massage. I love like the intensity in the massager's face and just the relaxed feeling of the recipient. And more of examples, okay. You guys got the idea, but all in all, candids really make you feel like you're back in that moment. For example, like this guy here, he just won 2,000 arcade tickets, which is insane. And that insane moment is captured in the expression, just the excitement of the subject's face. All right, so let's say that you're a photographer, you're learning, and you want to take these candids. What are some tips? Well, personally, emotions are everything. I tend to try to take happy emotions, so my tips are for like happy emotions. But one really important thing is to make your subject feel comfortable. You know, if they're not comfortable, if they're someone you don't really know well, they're probably more likely to be stiff. So make them laugh. I always like to tell my subjects, think of your favorite meme or something. And it'll always catch them off guard, but they'll laugh naturally and it'll be perfect for a candid. Also, if you're like maybe like taking pictures of something in action, always take lots and lots and lots of effective pictures. You're not going to get that perfect shot with just one click of the shutter.
David, I have a quick question. Yes. For the last slide you just went over, mm-hmm. taking a lot of consecutive pictures, that's like the same thing like if you're on a phone and you have like a burst, right?
Yes, that should be fine.
Cool. All
right, this was staged. I told my friends to squish together and this is the result of that. This was also staged. I just told them to make a funny face. So not all candids are true candids, but if you really want to capture that same feeling, it comes down to being able to get your subjects to feel comfortable, getting them to express genuine emotions. So what are some tips on that? How do we direct a photo? How do we, you know, maybe make the pose in the picture look better than usual? Maybe you take a picture of your friend and they look stiff as heck and you think this is not going to work. It boils down to being able, as a photographer, to direct your subject and tell them what to do. If you don't know any good poses, you don't know any good compositions, always, always, always use a reference, like going on Instagram or going on Google. Those are great resources. So just look at what other photographers have done and use that as a reference. When you're actually directing your subject and what to do, it can be kind of hard to communicate what you want them to pose. So I like to use the environment as a cue to help direct where each body part should go. For example, in this picture, my friend is looking like to the side. So what I told him to do was to look at the park that was like to the very left of him. And so that just let him turn naturally. Or for his foot, for example, I told him, hey, turn that foot like a little bit towards the river. So that's kind of how I directed this photo. And it's not like a pose that my friend would have naturally taken otherwise. So to wrap up, let's go pretty fast. But just to wrap up, take lots of pictures. Lots of pictures. You are probably gonna take a lot more bad pictures than good pictures. And that's the case for me too. In like 100 pictures, I probably have like 2 or 3 good ones. So don't feel discouraged if what you take doesn't make you feel satisfied or happy. Just keep on experimenting. I'm experimenting all the time. You should experiment too. That's how you're gonna get better. That's how you're gonna learn different techniques. And finally, just do what makes you happy. I know I talked a lot about different techniques and what I like to do in my photos, but I think a lot of photography is really finding what you think your style is, what you think makes you happy, and at the end of the day, that's what matters the most. So keep practicing. If you're interested in additional resources for editing, I recommend using Lightroom Mobile. This is just a great app in general. For tutorials, you can check out YouTube, and for inspiration, you know, check out Instagram and Google. So that about concludes my presentations. If there's any questions, feel free to put it in the chat or just use your voice.
Thank you so much for doing this, David. This was a great presentation. Specifically for the Lightroom Mobile, what would you recommend? Like, what is the go-to edit feature or whatever there is on that app? Like, for example, brightness or contrast?
The go-to feature, I think there's probably two things that I think can enhance your photos. The first thing is probably basic settings like light and shadow, contrast, the whites and the blacks. If you have bad lighting, for example, and you want to fix that, then if you pop it into Lightroom, and you can adjust the whites or the blacks in your photo. And that's what I always do. The second thing is, I forgot what it's called in Lightroom, but it allows you to edit the hues and the saturation of individual colors. It's called color grading, basically, and that lets you play around with the colors in your photo. If you've ever seen photographers that have like a lot of blues, a lot of oranges, or just a lot of like one color in their photos, that's how they do it. Yeah, and Emily said, look up the tutorial. There's a lot of different sliders, a lot of different options, but it enhances your photos a lot. Kevin's asking about polarizing lens. Polarizing lens are good if, I think they're used for when you have a lot of glare in a picture, like if you're taking a picture of water and you have like a lot of sun like hitting that water and has that reflection and like the water looks white. I think the polarizing lens reduces that glare. I think on one of my lenses, just like have them on permanently. The effect isn't huge most of the part, but a bonus is that it does protect your lens. So if you ever like shatter the filter, your lenses are safe. So I think it's a pretty good investment just to have. They're not too expensive, I think.
I had a question, I don't know if you know, but for Polaroids, there's like a couple of different like settings that you could set your Polaroid to. Do you know anything about the settings or like how they enhance the picture or like what's the best setting to have when you take a picture outside or anything like that?
Unfortunately, I've never used a Polaroid. I've been meaning to get one, but I'm not someone you should ask for a Polaroid advice.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else have any other questions before we conclude this how-to series? Okay, I guess that will wrap it up for us. Thank you so much for doing this, David. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you for all who attended today. I hope you guys learned something. I know I might have spoken a bit too fast at times, but yeah, go out there, take pictures, and try something new.
Yeah, this. If you would like to review this or any of the slides, it will be posted in the Facebook event page. And this will also be on our YouTube, IGTV, and currently we're on Facebook Live. So you can find all that there. Have a good weekend, everyone. Stay safe.